Apologies to you all if you've been having pictures receiving, having problems receiving the pictures. I believe you may have been in some areas of the country tonight. The storms apparently are whizzing around all over the place, especially down south. So apologies if you've had problems with us in the build-up. Do stay with us for the match. It's about to get underway. The teams are on the pitch, and we'll pick up our match commentator now, Peter Brackley, and at his elbow tonight, Ron Atkinson, Sheffield Wednesday manager.
Thank you, Paul. Good evening, everyone, and what a cracking tie we're looking forward to here. Aston Villa, of course, very much the team in form. Can Middlesbrough hold them here in this first leg? Well, let's take a look then at the Aston Villa side. Injury scares at the weekend, as you've heard, this cover. In the main, is the Villa side that's taken the first division by score. Right, it's been in goal. McGrath, Gage, Banfield, Nielsen, and Gray at the back. Coach David Black, what a pleasure to have him on the side. And captain's in midfield. Brian Holding, and the Bournemouth Royal. Middlesbrough side, one or two changes, late changes made by Bruce Rioch, the manager. We weren't expecting one or two of the names that have appeared. The two up front. So then we're all set for the off. Leicester Shapter is the referee for Torquay, and it's Aston Villa who kick off. The pitch is rather heavy. There's been a lot of rain over the past couple of days, and indeed there was a suggestion at one stage today that the match might have been called off. But Leicester Shapter had a good look and decided the pitch was certainly playable. We're all set now for hopefully a pulsating tie here. This is Kevin Gage for Aston Villa, attacking the goal to our left. Paul Birch coming in for Tony Daly, who's got an injury. Daly among the substitutes, so it could well be he'll feature sometime tonight, but Graham Taylor presumably deciding not to risk it for the full 90 minutes. Daly has been so important to Aston Villa. Paul Birch scored twice on Saturday, so he's no lead replacement. Well, Ron Atkinson alongside me here, your thoughts on how this might go and the approach that Middlesbrough might have to this one. Too well at the moment. We'll sort that one out and hear your views in just a second. So throw that to Aston Villa, who take it by Peter Gage. Bernie Slaven, key man for Middlesbrough. 21 goals from Slaven so far this season. And very much the man in form for Middlesbrough. Here's the free kick. Whacked upfield then by Gordon Cowards. Too long though for the lackey figure of Ermondroyd. And safely through to Stephen Pears. Goalkeeper for Middlesbrough. Parkinson up in search of Ripley. There was a tangle off the ball then. Kent Nielsen. Parkinson taking the throw. This is Ripley. Good solid tackle though by McGrath. One of these three central defenders that Aston Villa employ. A system that allows the two fullbacks to make progress in a very adventurous style down the flanks. Kevin Gage and Stuart Gray in those roles tonight. Here's McGrath, free header. This is Paul Kerr, former Aston Villa player. Away for the corner. Forced by Ripley. So no lack of confidence shown here by Middlesbrough in the opening minutes. And it'll be Mark Proctor to take the corner. And there for several supporters back behind that goal. Proctor again. Cross in, and a goal kick, appeals for a corner for the Middlesbrough players. There's the Shapter ruling in favour of Aston Villa. Stand up, stand up, stand up, stand up. at all. The Villa supporters relishing their team's success. 12 successive home wins, remember. And they've gone now 10 matches without defeat in any competition. The treble very much on at the moment. They're going well in the FA Cup, and of course, second only to Liverpool in the First Division. Parkinson for Middlesbrough. 19th in the Second Division, Middlesbrough. The feeling is they're a much better side than that might suggest. Here's Slaven. McGee, one of the younger players, drafted in by Bruce Rioch. Birch battling back for it. Pounds sways it wide. Stuart Gray looking for Oyman Royd. He's 6'4". Proctor. Minutes into the first half in this northern final of the Zenith Cup. We do apologise for one or two of the technical problems we've had so far. Ripley. Again, it was McGrath who came across. Ron Atkinson has found his voice now. Ron, your thoughts on the early minutes?
Yes, Bruce Rioch made a bold tactical situation. He's played three front, out-and-out front players. We thought Kernaghan would come in and play as a defender. I have seen him play up front before, but that's enabled Bernie Slaven, who's probably their main striker, to play virtually as a left-sided striker. They're playing Ripley, Kernaghan and Slaven up front, I would think, to occupy Villa's three central defenders.
It certainly seems a bold move by Bruce Rioch. A man, of course, who knows all about Aston Villa from his time at Villa Park. Great international of the past, Bruce Rioch. He's up against a master tactician too, of course, it's Graham Taylor of Aston Villa. Now off goes Ian Olney. Simon Coleman, though, with the covering tackle. Parkinson looking for Ripley. Released and hounded by McGrath. Ripley holding him off well. Stuart Ripley, a player with a lot of pace, is Graham Taylor. Looking on will be well aware. But Taylor, I know, was really impressed with his team showing against Port Vale. They absolutely annihilated them on Saturday in the Cup. A match I know you saw on.
Yes, so they were tremendous. It's the best performance I've seen from an Aston Villa side in years. And the great thing about them, even when they're 4-5 up, they still kept at it. There was no easing up. Very much a mark of a side in form.
Ripley beaten in the air by Kent Nielsen. There's Kevin Gage. And you saw, of course, the tackle on David Platt, and it was feared he may have broken his leg at first, but obviously the injury was not as serious as it may have seemed at first. But Graham Taylor was very unhappy about the tackle on.
Yeah, well, I've got to be honest with you there, Peter, I actually didn't see it. I was just going out the ground when it happened.
We won't ask you any more about it then. Still no score yet. It's Middlesbrough taking the game here to Aston Villa. They certainly don't appear to have come here just to defend. Given away then by Kernaghan. He was wrong to saying, has certainly played up front in the past. We thought he might have taken up a defensive role. But it is an adventurous policy.
Yes, but I've got a feeling he's going to be needed defensively though, Peter, because looking round at the side, they're a little bit short of height. I think him and Ripley are going to have to come back when Villa have set plays, because they're exceptionally dangerous, Aston Villa, on corners and free kicks.
There are so many tall players in the Aston Villa side. That's the tallest of them all, Ormond Droyd. Here's another one, Ian Olney. They're the two up front. And of course, they had these three central defenders to plant forward as well on set pieces. And here's Kerr, so anxious to impress against his old club. Brennan, threading it through, as a glorious pass. Oh, just offside. Marvellous through ball then, though, from Brennan, the former Ipswich player.
Yeah, I think that's a tactic that Middlesbrough may be well advised to use, playing the ball, the angle ball, through the Villa back line, because by virtue of the fact they push their full backs on, it means there is an awful lot of space behind the central defenders. and people with the pace of Ripley, and Kernaghan's quick as well, you know, Peter. He's quick, he caused us a lot of problems in the earlier round.
McGrath, of course, has exceptional pace, but there is a slight suspicion about perhaps Kent Nielsen's pace. McGrath taking the free kick. Ormondroyd to Gray. Stuart Gray operating on the left-hand side for Aston Villa with Gage on the right. Chris Price out of the starting lineup tonight. And that, I think, surprised you a bit, Ron. Chris Price not in the side.
Yes, particularly the way Villa play. I mean, Price is ideal suited for this system. He's a fast-rating fullback. But in all fairness to them on Saturday, Gage had a great game at left-back and then in midfield in the second half. And Stuart Gray came on and scored two brilliant free kicks.
And that is the thing about Aston Villa. They have so many versatile players, so many utility players. And here's another one, an exceptional one too, at David Platt. Roar around the ground when it was announced that Platt was playing. He really is having an outstanding season, and of course, he now is an England international too, and hoping to be in the World Cup squad in Italy. And here's the free kick. We take it by Cowards. Four players in that six-yard area. Difficult ball for the goalkeeper, but Piers holding on well.
Yes, I was going to say, they scored their first goal from that self-same free kick on Saturday, and Bruce Rioch was actually at the game. I notice he's done his homework. He actually put a wall up just, 10 yards off the dead ball line to make sure that Cowans had to lift the ball, whereas normally he tries to drive it into the near post.
Long ball then, and too long from Birch. Here's the throw taken by McGee for Middlesbrough. Young Owen McGee. On the bench for Middlesbrough is Trevor Putney, who's been out through injury but was back in the reckoning for this game. But Bruce Rioch has preferred instead young Owen McGee. Proctor. A lot of experience, of course, for the likes of Proctor and Slaven here now. Good tackle though by McGrath. And then a wrestling match between Slaven and Cowans, which results in a free kick to Aston Villa. Warren Cowans, the playmaker of the Aston Villa side, and he really has been playing well this season. His second spell, of course, with Aston Villa, having played for a while with Bari in Italy. But so far, Aston Villa not fully into their stride. And Graham Taylor has appealed to the crowd not to expect another six goals, as of course they witnessed against Port Vale on Saturday. Proctor. Oh, great mistake by him. It's Kernaghan with a shooting chance. The strength was perfectly placed, but a slip then by Stuart Gray. And perhaps the conditions playing a part then.
There's good situation in that. I think a more experienced striker than Kernaghan would have run that on. I think he could have taken on three or four more yards and perhaps got closer to spin.
But it could have been a costly error by Stuart Gray. And here we can see it again. A long, long way out. No real problem for a goalkeeper of Nigel Spink's quality. On from Ormondroyd. Here's Olney. Two work so well in tandem. Gray. Platt was lurking in the middle. Ormondroyd there too. Middlesbrough happy to clear upfield. McGrath. McGrath's career revived at Aston Villa. Throw taken by Gray. Olney. Easily cut out though by Proctor. And Ripley was a lone figure upfield. Platt to, well, Birch. He could be in here. Is this the first goal? Yes! Driven in by Birch. Platt provided the pass, and Paul Birch with a stunning finish. A marvellous through ball then from Platt, who's such an intelligent player. He spotted Birch away to his right, and Birch finished it off in style. Here's Platt now. He spotted the opening, and how well Birch accepted the opportunity. And the battle is on now for Middlesbrough. Can they contain this rampant Aston Villa side? Ron Atkinson.
Yeah, super goal. Great vision by Platt. A very good finish by Birch. Little bit unfortunate there for Middlesbrough because they've made a very, very good start, really. It stifled Aston Villa fairly well in midfield, and that's the first real menacing attack Villa have had.
So Paul Birch on the mark again. Two goals from him, remember, against Port Vale on Saturday. And he's notched up another one here. Great start then for Aston Villa. Very much the team of the moment. And is this another one? Is Stuart Gray in there this time? And they do have so many options. Aston Villa, so many players who can score goals. And of course, there's this tremendous confidence about their play at the moment.
It's ironic, isn't it? I mean, Birch has been out the side. He's only got inside because Daly's injured. And Daly's probably their informed player over the last few weeks. And Birch has got in and scored over the weekend three cracking goals.
Paul McGrath is getting ticking off then from Leicester Shapter. That's the thing though, Rob, when a side is going well, if you get in, you have to take your chance when it comes your way. Parkinson then with the free kick. Can Middlesbrough bounce straight back again? A header, oh! It's gone in! In off Gage. What a way for Middlesbrough to reply. Slaven was in there. It may well have come off Gage in the end. Slaven will claim the goal. Here's the free kick. Spink claws it onto the bar. And Slaven, I think they've got the final touch.
Yeah, Slaven's a natural scorer. He's a sniffer, and he certainly sniffed that one out.
Well, what a cup time we have on now. Slaven touches it over the line, and Middlesbrough are right back in this game. It's 1-1. What a cup time we have on now.
I would think Villa would be particularly peeved at that, because that's one of their copybook moves, isn't it? Freak set play situation. Big fella getting the touch on.
It's the Middlesbrough fans now who are making themselves heard. Two goals then for Bernie Slaven this season, and that's his sixth in this competition, and he's relishing this game here now. Middlesbrough rising to the occasion. Pass from Gage, only struggling to keep it in play. Here's McGee with the throw then. No fear at the moment that Middlesbrough are going to be overrun in this first leg. And remember, there's another 90 minutes to come at Earson Park in the second leg. Terrific atmosphere now around Villa Park. In towards Platt, fighting for the corner, and it's given. That'll be the signal for the big men to come up from the back yet again.
Yeah, this is a tremendous test for Middlesbrough, these sort of situations, because without Mowbray, they've got a very, very young and inexperienced back four.
Here's the corner. Cowans didn't find Birch. Slaven. Now for Proctor. Beaten, though, by Cowans. Here's Tony Mowbray, the Middlesbrough captain, out through suspension. So they've had to reshuffle the side. Mowbray, as Ron was saying, a central and key figure for them at the back, and we were wondering how much they were going to miss him. Mountfield, one of the doubtful Villa players before the game, but he's come through a fitness test. One of those three men at the back, the former Everton man, Derek Mountfield. McGrath underneath this. Yes, Stuart Gray. They do well to keep that in play. It's now pouring with rain here at Villa Park. Pitch, as I was saying earlier, already rather heavy in parts. But sometimes that makes for a really exciting cup tie. And at the moment, this one is living up to that prospect. Here's McGrath. Former Manchester United man, whose career has been revived at Villa Park. What a move that's turning out for him.
dry up here on the television gantry. There are some supporters out there who are getting absolutely soaked, but they're enjoying the action. Olley looking for Birch. It's McGee who steers it safely back to Piers.
Peter, a lot's been made of the Villa's revival, and rightly so. They've had a magnificent form run, as you were saying earlier. But it's all coincided since Cowan's came into the side. Looking at it today, he's the man that makes them tick in the middle of the park. He's the passer. He controls things. I notice Mark Proctor is very, very close to him.
It's Cowan's now, sliding the ball off in search of Ormond Roy. Tackle was from Parkinson.
And I think that's a situation, Peter, you'll find throughout the game. I think you'll find that Proctor will try and snuff Cowan's out, and Brennan will be given the responsibility of trying to hang on to the other midfield, David Platt.
Cowan's threading it through. Gray was off in search of it. Here's McGrath. The roadblock tackle. Didn't find Ormond Roy, though. And it was Kerr who came across to cover. Yes, there has been talk that Cowan's is perhaps showing even England potential again. He is, of course, a former international. But that's the kind of form that Gordon Cowan's has been in. Nielsen's header. Here's Slaven, the goal scorer for Middlesbrough. It's 1-1 here at Villa Park in the northern final of the Zenith Cup. And it certainly isn't a one-way contest. Middlesbrough have come here, they've played with purpose. And I think it's pretty fair to say they deserve to be where they are at the moment. Holding Aston Villa, the joint leaders of the First Division. Ripley. Powerful header forward by Coleman. And Spick had to reach. Ormond Roy. Now he's got away from Parkinson. Looking to take defenders on. He's so hard to deal with. But Middlesbrough managed to do so effectively. Kernaghan's intended pass. He's got a second chance here. Middlesbrough, the players streaming forward, but to no avail, and it's Mountfield to tidy up at the back for Aston Villa. Ian Olney, 11 goals from him so far this season. A young player who's come on in leaps and bounds in the Villa side. Ian Olney, young striker indeed. What a transformation in this fellow's career. Ormond Roy, who was booed and jeered every time he touched the ball by Aston Villa fans earlier in the season, now he's their hero. Here's Platt.
Certainly Platt doesn't look to be showing any signs of his injury, does he? He looks as sharp as a needle.
Well, it was, as we were saying, a quite astonishing recovery by David Platt. Appears that he might be up for a long time. As Ron's saying, we've not seen any sign of it so far. Now here's Ripley, he's done well here.
Away, away! Away!
The service there wasn't good enough. Mountfield for Aston Villa. Ormond Roy lost it on the greasy surface. The flag's up for offside, but referee Shapter waving play on, hoping that Villa will take up the advantage. There's the Shapter, who's been around on the scene a good few years now. He was at Wembley last season, he was in the band. He played in the band when Torquay played Bolton. He comes from Torquay, and his team were in the then Sherpa Van Trophy final. And he thoroughly enjoyed his day, I can tell you. Brennan. You didn't know that, Ron, did you, that he played in the band?
No, I know people in the game that thinks that would have been his best position.
I didn't say that, Ron, you did.
Only joking, Lester.
Cowan's beavering away in midfield. Here's Stuart Gray. Ormond Roy swapping passes. Here's Gray. But Parkinson sticking to his task well. Gary Parkinson, right fullback for Middlesbrough. Here's Stuart Gray. Platt's in the middle. Birch was there too, but easily away by Coleman. Cowan's to Birch. Proctor's tackle. Now Slaven. Off goes Ripley. We've got to watch his acceleration. But the Dane, Kent Nielsen, got the better of him that time. Ormondroyd. Record signing for Aston Villa, Ormondroyd from Bradford City. Certainly wasn't a success at first, but very much so now. I'm hoping that he can be part of this Villa side that they hope can go on to the treble. The FA Cup, the league, and of course the Zenith Cup. Ormondroyd. McGuire in support and Gray here. Cairns driving it through. Piers keeping a careful eye on the shot then from Gordon Cowans. Carnigan. Slaven lurking in the middle. Still Carnigan. Curling it. Away for the corner. Five outfield.
There's that little situation again where Kernaghan's picked the ball up behind the orthodox left-back position and been allowed to run at the defence. Showed a fair amount of skill there as well.
A corner then to Middlesbrough. Be taken by Proctor. They've got some big fellows in there too, Middlesbrough. Spink with a comfortable catch. The longest serving player on Aston Villa's books now. Spink, remember, who made his name back in 1982 when he came on as a substitute in the European Cup final. It's 1-1. Aston Villa taking the lead through Birch, but then Middlesbrough coming straight back with a goal from Bernie Slaven, his 22nd of the season. And the action so far has been fast and furious. Mountfield with the back pass. This is the first of five live games that we'll be bringing you on Sky from the Zenith Cup. Of course, we have the second leg of this one, the Southern Area Final, two legs again, and the final itself at Wembley. And that is the prize now that these players are playing for. Aston Villa haven't been at Wembley for a few years now. 13 years ago, they last played there in the final of the League Cup. And Middlesbrough haven't enjoyed that measure of success in the past. I wonder if this is going to be their year. It's Kerr. Ripley sprinting away to his right. Here's Ripley now. It's a good tackle though by Nielsen, who's a very competent defender. Current Danish international. The Danes, of course, just missing out on a World Cup final place. But Middlesbrough so far on, giving a very good account of themselves.
They've played exceptionally well. And what they have done, they've prevented Villa from getting mass attacks. I mean, Villa's way of playing is to leave only up the field as a central striker, isolate him a little bit, and then flood him from with people like Platt, Birch and Ormondroyd getting up to him in support. That hasn't happened today because Middlesbrough have kept the ball so well.
Coley underneath this one. And a push from behind. The referee seeing nothing wrong. There's Gray with a header. And as far as Kerr. McGrath. Trying to set Ormondroyd on his way. There was Parkinson again. Really featured as a central striker in the past, Ormondroyd, but he's found his niche down that left flank. Now here's Cairns. Weave it through. And a shot from his right foot. Wide of the post. Cairns already making his impact on this game. McGrath is giving it away though to Kerr, who was first to react. Gray with the foot in. Mountfield for Aston Villa. 1-1 at Villa Park in his first leg of the Northern Final of the Zenith Cup. A wet and blustery night in Birmingham. The crowd immersed in this cup tie. Olney. Here's Birch. scorer of the Aston Villa goal. And well there too. Good save though by Pierce. But Birch determined that Aston Villa don't miss Tony Daly tonight. Came off McGrath. Paul Birch for Aston Villa, and Bernie Slaven has been in cracking form, fighting back straight away for Middlesbrough. Free kick to Middlesbrough. Coleman has come up from the back. Here's the free kick. It swirled in the wind. Very strong wind, as I was saying, here in the Midlands. Mohan with McGee. Half an hour of the first half gone. It's 1-1. Out though, and Mohan able to guide it back to Pierce under pressure from Ian Olney.
Do you think that's the big difference between today's game and the one I saw here on Saturday, is the fact that the Villa midfield players, certainly at this moment in time, haven't been allowed to get past their strikers at all? They've been kept pretty well in check by the Middlesbrough midfield.
Here's Kerr. Cowart's hitting the long ball for Olney to chase. But Mohan had read the situation well. And Mohan has gone down hurt there. Just 19 years old, a youth training scheme. Survivor, that's the word. He's not surviving too well at the moment.
There's a big responsibility on him, Peter. Without Mowbray on the side, somebody like Mohan, the young left-back McGee, it's a big ordeal for them. This boy played in the corresponding game last season, Mohan. He played left-back in that match. In fact, it was virtually the game that put Middlesbrough down into the second division.
So unlucky, really, Middlesbrough to be relegated at the end of last season. They hadn't been in the bottom three until the last day. But it all turned south for them. And I saw them quite a few times earlier in the season. They looked a fair side. Certainly Bruce Shriocka's put together a useful format. So Mohan is all right again.
I think it should also be pointed out, Peter, that this has always in the past been a very, very lucky ground for them. They've had some very good results in the last 5 or 6 years here at Villa Park.
I also have to point out they had an excellent result against Sheffield Wednesday, Ron's team in this competition, beating them by 4-1.
Certainly three of them were well off circuit. They really were.
At least he's given them the fourth goal anyway. So we'll call it a one-all draw, shall we, Ron? Here's Olney. It's 1-1 here, and it's quite a battle out there. Here's Gray. Ormondroyd. The crowd doing their best to lift Aston Villa. They certainly aren't playing with the fluency they showed against Port Vale. Birch now at the gauge. Flats in the middle. Ormondroyd. That one has gone way, way over the bar.
To me, Peter, that represents the Villa's best chance today. The very fact that Middlesbrough haven't got an orthodox left-sided midfield player. They've got a young left-back playing against Birch. And there's all sorts of space for Gage to be able to come forward into. As I say, that'll be a little bit of a trying time for young McGee at left-back now. He's going to have to play sometimes two against one there.
Here's Platt. Joy for Stuart Gray. Callahan. Now Ripley. Tangling with McGrath. Oh, this is all very silly. And these two could be in real trouble here.
they'll do exceptionally well to stay on, the pair of them. There's been a little flare-up between them before, just before that.
Stuart Ripley and Paul McGrath will both be spoken to at the very least by Lester Shapter.
Well, I've seen this referee send people up for a lot less than that.
Well, let's see what he does here. Perhaps he'll decide that in the heat of the moment these things happen, but they're certainly all rather silly. McGrath clashing with Stuart Ripley. And I wonder, Ron, if they're going to get off with a warning. I think they are.
I've got to say that I really can't believe that. I mean, it would have been a shame to see either of them walk, because Ripley looks to be the most exciting attacker on the field, and everybody knows what I would think of big Paul McGrath. But I think they're both very, very lucky there.
Well, here's Brennan with the free kick. Certainly did seem that a punch was thrown in there. Away by Ormondroyd as the rain sweeps across Willow Park.
Anyway, I suppose you could say common sense has now prevailed.
We'll leave it at that, Ron. Here's McGee with the throw. Ripley and McGrath still jostling with each other. Right on the edge of the area. 10 minutes to half-time. It's 1-1. The ball was out of play. The linesman flagging over on the far side. And he's been spotted now by referee Shapter. But Ripley and McGrath lucky to stay on the field. After those fisticuffs. McGee again looking for the long throw. Spicks come for it. Stuart Ripley, as Ron was saying, he's shown terrific pace, and he has embarrassed Aston Villa on one or two occasions so far in this game. Ripley's after him. This could be interesting. It came off Ripley. But let's look at the positive side of Paul McGrath, Ron. I mean, he really has had his career resurrected here, hasn't he?
Yeah, to be fair, the boy, there's none better. He is. He's a superb defender. Great lad, superb defender. Probably the emotions of the night have got to them both. They're both playing very competitive. Ripley's had a right kick at him there, to be fair, now. Big Paul, I think, is just trying to pacify him here. Just trying
to pacify
him in a very unorthodox manner, I might add.
Well, he's had his problems, of course, Paul McGrath, not only with injury, but with his temperament too. He says he's off the drink, though, now, Ron. So that's something. Mind you, Oliver Reed said that once. Ormondroyd. Here's Olney. Parkinson with the throw for Middlesbrough. Very much in this northern final. It's the first leg. Of course, if it stays this way, well, then you'd have to fancy Middlesbrough for the second leg up at Ayrton Park. Although, of course, we've seen what a capable side Aston Villa are in this current campaign. And all this after they were so nearly relegated last season, just one place above the relegation zone, Aston Villa. It's been a different story this time. Here's Platt now. Villa looking for a little bit of magic from David Platt.
So ironic, that game I was talking about to you earlier, last season here. Stuart Gray, I think, equalised with the very last kick of a game in which Middlesbrough had been the better side. And it so worked out that if he hadn't done it, Middlesbrough would have stayed up and Villa would have gone down. Well, ironic, isn't it, when you see the success they're having now?
They certainly are. It's all been going so well for Aston Villa. Good jump then by Coleman. Here's Stuart Gray. Now for Birch. Platt. Referee waving him on. And a little for the defence. Again doing its job. There's McGrath in before Ripley. Nielsen. Ormondroyd. Finding Cowans. and he fails to find Stuart Gray. Kerr to Proctor. Having a good steady game in midfield, Mark Proctor. Had a spell, of course, with Sunderland, with Nottingham Forest, Sheffield Wednesday, so he's been around a bit. Now back at Middlesbrough. Proctor in there with Cowans. Brennan hoisting it forward in search of Ripley. Platt as the ball holds up in the wind. Mountfield's lost it. But it's a Villa throw. Birch leading it for Kevin Gage, the former Wimbledon man. Here's Birch now, scorer of the first goal. It's 1-1 at Villa Park, this first leg of the Northern final of the Zenith Cup. The match brought to you live by Sky. Cowans, rather careless then though. Hooked on by Kernahan. Ripley. Kernahan again. And drivers after him. Here's Cowans. But at no time have Villa been allowed to settle in this first half.
No, I think it should be pointed out they're playing against a fairly strong wind as well, Peter, which is enabling Middlesbrough to push the game right up into their half of the field, into the Villa half of the field. Another thing they've done, once again, for credit to Bruce Rioch. He's seen that Big Omeroyd's a hell of a runner, hell of a sprinter if he gets turned round, and he's virtually making sure that Parkinson doesn't let him get a head of steam up against him. He's marking him very, very tightly.
Aston Villa 1, Middlesbrough 1. 5 minutes of the first half to go. Good touch off then by Olney. Birch almost got away then from Mohan. Being roundly jeered by the Middlesbrough supporters, who turned out in force here. McGrath is not their favourite person at the moment. Ormond Droy. Brennan was in strongly, and it's Proctor who's down injured. Quickly back and on with the game. Free kick to Middlesbrough, is it or a throw? It's going to be a throw. Both teams keeping up the pace in this cup tie. It was a foul night in Birmingham. Free kick to Aston Villa.
I just wonder in the second half if when Villa come out with the wind at the back, I wouldn't be surprised to see David Platt pushed up alongside Olney. And maybe go to a more orthodox 4-4-2 situation, or 4-2-4.
With the wind behind them, it might be a different story in the second half. At the moment, Middlesbrough holding on well. Although they have conceded another free kick here. Birch wants to take it quickly. But here's Cowans instead. Ormond Droy and Olney, he was looking for. Gray back in again. Parkinson only as far as Cowans! Struck it well, but not on the target. But Cowans really enjoying a fresh lease of life back at Aston Villa. Got hold of that one well. Middlesbrough not clearing it away sufficiently. Parkinson with a header, and Cowans on his right foot. A little bit off balance then, I think.
Yeah, that's the second shot he's had from following up situations. Edge of the box, drop areas, and he does crack a fair old ball, Cowans. He's a beautiful striker, and I think Middlesbrough have done well to restrict Villa to a very few corners and free kicks in danger areas.
Olney. Hustled out of it, though, but Ormond Droyd challenging with Piers. He's got to go all the way now, and he did.
I don't believe why players do that at all. I mean, the boy might only be a youngster, but the number of defenders now that do that to play unnecessary back passes that put people in trouble.
It's a corner then to Aston Villa. As the roar emerges around Villa Park. It's a free header then. The marking was rather sloppy at the back. Here's McGrath. Now, Stuart Gray. Gage. Is it going to reach? Speak to Gray. Flat. Now Paul McGrath. Off again goes the beanpole. Ian Ormondroy. He's not an easy player to mark. Cowans. Too slow then though. Caught in possession by Proctor. And a break could be on here for Middlesbrough. Mountfield. Birch to Gage. Villa hoping to end the first half with a flourish. Platts. Oh, off the ball! Again, they were careless at the back. And David Platt almost made Middlesbrough pay for it. His shot cannoned off the bar. It was a poor header across the goal. And Platt whack against the bar.
Yeah, I mean, that's David Platt at his best, supporting and even getting in advance of the strikers.
And Aston Villa denied, it's still 1-1. But a real opportunity then for David Platt. 19 goals, remember, going into this game. To take the free kick. Kent Nielsen has gone forward. Ormondroy is in there too. And Olney and Platt. Olney. Whistle's gone for half time. Might just have been in the nick of time then, I think, for Middlesbrough. The ball is at the feet of David Platt. But a good first half. Paul Birch giving Aston Villa the lead. But what a response then from Middlesbrough. Coming straight back for the goal from Bernie Slaven. And that's how it is at half-time. Plenty more to look forward to, I'm sure, in the second half. It's Aston Villa 1, Middlesbrough 1.
Northern final first leg, half gone and a half to go, and every prospect in the second half are very different conditions to what we've enjoyed so far. Mr. Lorenzo down at pitch side is not enjoying it. He will explain why.
Well, the news from pitchside, Paul, is that you definitely got the better end of this deal. It's pouring down here, and it has done ever since they kicked off. Referee Lester Shapter had a pitch inspection. In fact, he had two before the game started. The pitch was heavy then. He said the game would go ahead. I wonder what he would have done if he had to make a decision about the pitch in the state it's in now. It's very heavy out there. They'll be calling a lot on the stamina of both teams. But with a game like we've got, I'm sure the crowd are quite happy to stay around for the second half. Back to you, Paul.
He looks pretty happy himself. He's paid to do it, that's why. Peter, it's going to get very heavy out there second half. Who's going to have the legs?
I'm very surprised actually about the pitch, because the pitch is normally in great condition. Normally they put a cover on it, but it's going to cut up and it's going to be heavy and it's going to be tiring on the legs.
In the back of the players' minds now at half time, are they saying, look, we've got to get ahead in this game, or are they saying, you know, there's a second leg at Ayresome Park next week, which we'll be covering incidentally, let's play for that now? Well, what do they think?
I would be saying to them, I would say, you've got to go out and try and get goals, really. It doesn't matter whether it's Middlesbrough or Aston Villa. Aston Villa, certainly, because they're on home territory, to try and get some home goals. Middlesbrough may be saying to themselves, look, we've had a great first half. We can maybe beat them.
And the thought for Middlesbrough especially, very rare they get the chance to go to Wembley.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, they're struggling in the league, but the cup is a different kettle of fish, and they've done brilliant. And as I say, they've got nothing to lose. They've got to get them back up there, and they've got a great chance, I think.
OK, Peter. We'll go back to Peter Brackley for coverage of the second half, match commentator with Ron Atkinson of Sheffield Wednesday. And a new man is on the park, Peter.
Yes, indeed. Yes,
yes. Mr. Price is on.
Price is on, and McGrath is off. Chris Price on at the start of the second half. He's got put tapped to the cold, first of all. Whether McGrath is injured or perhaps for other reasons, Graham Taylor is not putting him on in the second half. That is definitely the change. So Chris Price looks as if he's slotting into the right back position. Ron Atkinson, your thoughts on that move?
Yes, well, I wouldn't be surprised if Graham has pulled him off just to protect the boy, if anything. But it would now seem that they will definitely play an orthodox back four. And you'll still see Price attacking. He'll still come in a raiding role because that's his natural game. But
They'll play with two orthodox central defenders now, and as I said just before half-time, Gage will go into midfield and Platt will go up front, I would guess.
It looks as if that's what's going to happen in the second half, so we're all set then. Leicester Shakhtar is about to set the second half underway. Middlesbrough in the white shirts and red shorts attacking the goal to our left in the second half. If you're just joining us, it's 1-1. A good first half, Villa taking the lead through Paul Birch, but Bernie Slaven equalising almost immediately for Middlesbrough. And the second division side certainly haven't been overawed by their first division opponents here. The two number sevens scoring the goals so far. David Platt striking the bar for Aston Villa. Mountfield was in the way. Here's Proctor. Proctor again. McCown's in possession now for Aston Villa. And as Ron Atkinson was saying, David Platt has been pushed further forward. And still, it's pouring down with rain. How'd you fancy being out in that tonight? Unusual headwear. It's a free kick to Middlesbrough. Parkinson to take it for them. Very much in contention in this northern final of the Zenith Cup. Whistle's gone for some pushing free kick to Aston Villa.
Yeah, I think that's going to give the Middlesbrough young defenders a hell of a problem, that, because early on they were nice and tidy. The one defender marked only and the other sat out and picked up the spare bits. Now all of a sudden both central defenders have got jobs to do, defensive marking jobs to do, and I just wonder how they'll cope with that.
Flicked down then by Ripley. Stuart Gray. Only half cut out then by Proctor. Ormondroy. Gray was sloppy then with his passing. Swirling, the rain falling hard, and conditions certainly aren't getting any easier. And he's Bruce Rehock, the Middlesbrough manager, is in the dry over there, and I would think he'd be pretty satisfied with the way that his team are playing, holding Aston Villa here at Villa Park, where Villa, remember, have won 12 successive home matches. Graham Taylor, I think his team can step up a gear in the second half. Alongside him there, physio Jim Walker. Kernigham. Pass going astray though again from Stuart Gray. So Villa yet to settle in the second half. Middlesbrough put up a stirring display against Everton before going out of the FA Cup. So they've taken a shine to cup football this season. Everton needing replays before they finally ousted them. Now the chase is on here. Mountfield equal to the task. Chris Price for Aston Villa. Brennan. McCarr finding Ripley. Has he got away here from Nielsen? Just too far. He really has toiled away up front, Stuart Ripley. He's caused problems with his pace. And I expect he's relieved that Paul McGrath is no longer on the field.
Just about to say that, Peter, bearing in mind that Big Paul has got lightning recovery pace. Now all of a sudden, Mantle's reasonably quick, but Nielsen, if he has got a weakness, if he does struggle for pace in the turn.
So can Middlesbrough exploit that in the second half? A gripping cup tie. Cowans for Aston Villa. Ormondroy paddling his way through the mud. Looks ungainly, but he was persistent then. Here's Stuart Gray. Scored twice in the cup tie against Port Vale. Both from free kicks, Stuart Gray. Gage. Middlesbrough with just about everybody, bar Ripley, now back defending. Chris Price. Nielsen looking for Ormondroyd. What's a missed kick then by Mohan? He's in trouble here. Gray missing out. Ripley. Time for Kent Nielsen. Looking for Birch. Missed kick then by McGee. But he's got away with it. Goal kick.
So that's the area I feel that Villa themselves could make good progress, particularly when Price starts to come on one or two of the bombing raids, which he's very, very good at. The young lad, McGee at left, playing in the left-back position, he's not quite sure whether to push forward and mark Birch, who's playing on the right-hand side of Villa's midfield. And now at this situation, he's got to start thinking of giving his central defender some cover, bearing in mind they're now both acting as markers.
McGee, just 19 years old, so it's a testing night for him. 1-1. The Northern final, first leg of the Zenith Cup. These pictures coming to you live from Villa Park. Bernie Slaven, scorer of the Middlesbrough goal. Here's McGee. Price to Platt. Rode the tackle well. It was a strong run from Coleman. Here's Kerr. Now, could the ex-Villa man do something here? Ripley in for Kernigham. Brennan. Villa have cleared this one effectively at all. Shot from Kerr! Well, he gritted his teeth there and he was very, very close. Just over the bar. Well worked move then by Middlesbrough. Villa in a little bit of a tangle at the back. And when the chance came Kerr's way, he came very close to accepting it. Good effort. Paul Kerr, a bit of a fringe player really in his time at Aston Villa. Oh, he nearly made an end for himself there. Remember Villa, unbeaten in 10 matches. Those 12 wins in a row at home, it's an awesome record for Middlesbrough to face, but they're holding up to the task extremely well. And if Kerr had been an inch or two lower then, it could well have been a second goal for Middlesbrough. Here's Ripley, looking to take on Price, and he was caught then. His ankles were nicked by Paul Birch.
It's been a great start, hasn't it? Middlesbrough, the second half, they come out, they pass the ball about and play very neat and tidy, and they've taken the game with the belief that they think they can win it.
They've set forward the two central defenders, Mohan and Coleman, hoping to add their presence in there with Kernigham. Proctor with the free kick. And the wind perhaps helped it behind the far post, with Nigel Spick watching it all the way. Mark Proctor, a good solid performer in the heart of the midfield for Middlesbrough. Nice warm drink, nearly, but on a night like this, it's getting a mite chilly now. Missed kick by Ormondroyd, presenting the ball to Kerr. Off Gray then for a throw to Middlesbrough. Vocal encouragement from the Borough supporters, and the Villa fans hoping to boost their team too. But here's Brennan. Now can he go all the way here? Still Brennan, has a chance. Kernahan. He couldn't finish off the job. But Villa were reeling then. It's a very muddy penalty area. Alan Kernahan, who's been quite a consistent goal scorer, had a chance then.
Not only that, Peter, the ball was set up at one stage in the movement for Brennan to have a dip, and he's got a fierce left foot. I'm amazed he didn't take a crack himself there.
It's a throw to Villa. They've had to survive some pressure from Middlesbrough at the start of the second half. What a cup tie we have on. Ormondroyd off Oldie. Brennan away. Now the break is on here with Slaven leading the charge. Ripley is forward at Kernahan. No chance of Slaven matching on to the return pass. Price away, but not as far as McGee. Here's Brennan. Proctor was hit very quickly then. 10 minutes of the second half, and so far most of the questions in the second 45 minutes being posed by Middlesbrough. What a battle they're giving Aston Villa. McGee taking the throw. Come on Villa, they're shouting now, the supporters of Aston Villa. And their team struggling at the moment. And here we can see again that opportunity for Middlesbrough. There's the chance for Brennan, and he might have thought about the shot there. The Villa defender sliding all over the place. Brennan persevering, and here's Callahan with a chance, and he couldn't turn it past Spink.
Got a funny old feeling Bernie Slaven in that same situation might have put them in the lead. Just looking over there, it looks as if Tony Daly's warming up with a bit of beauty perhaps coming on.
Well, he's the man whose lightning pace has been such a feature of Aston Villa's play this season. I wonder if Graham Taylor is going to throw him on now. Nielsen. Villa certainly need pepping up now. Not underneath this one, but beaten easily in the air by Coleman. Player they rate highly, Coleman. Simon Coleman at the back.
Actually, he had an outstanding game against Everton in the second replay last week. He did exceptionally well, and to be fair, at the moment, I'm making probably the best player on the field.
But here's Platt now for Aston Villa. Looking to get something started for them. Gray in towards Ormond Droid, who's such a threat in the air. Holney was lurking in there too. But away come Middlesbrough. And still the rain sweeps across the ground. Ripley. Surface certainly very slippery now from all this rain. It's Tony Daly warming up for Aston Villa. He could be on soon. Here's Coleman, who was signed really as a replacement for Gary Pallister when he left for Manchester United. And he's been very effective at the back. And here's Stephen Pearce. Had his problems, as I was saying earlier, with injuries. And he's reclaimed the first team jersey. Cowans, Norman Roy, looping off. He won't catch that one though. So Tony Daly, are we going to see his exceptional pace in a moment or two? The player they've talked about as a possible England contender, Tony Daly. Such has been his form for Aston Villa. Pearce will try again. Ripley. Here's McGee. Off goes Ripley again. Throw to Aston Villa. Ron Atkinson alongside me here. You're playing Aston Villa fairly soon. What conclusions have you drawn about them so far?
Well, certainly having seen them twice in the last few days, it looks you've obviously got to work very hard against them, and that is exactly what Middlesbrough have done. I mean, they've taken some of their main threats out, worked them hard, and they've done their share of closing down. I mean, they've given them very little room to play in the middle of the field.
Well, here's David Platt now then for Aston Villa. So many doubts about Platt's fitness, but he seems to have come through this game okay.
Yes, I wouldn't think there's any doubt at all about his fitness level. He looks... He looks as if he's got the capacity to work hard, and it doesn't appear to have affected his sharpness. Having said that, I'm just looking at him, looks to be limping.
Coleman with the free kick for Middlesbrough. Slaven, he handled that. He didn't think so. Leicester Shapter did. He's the one that counts. It's a free kick to Aston Villa.
Certainly Kernaghan and Ripley are proving a handful for the two big central defenders.
And that's going to be too long for Olney as the ball travelled quickly over the surface. There are the Borough fans, grouped behind Stephen Pearce's goal. A long way down here from Middlesbrough. They don't seem to mind it though, they're soaking wet. But Middlesbrough are doing rather well. And here they come now. Kernan, given away though. Certainly these players are going to be very tired at the end. The pitch sapping their strength. A good ball from Cowans. Ormondroyd. Platt was waiting in the middle, hoping for the cross. Middlesbrough playing themselves out of trouble. Mountfield with a header. And a throw to Aston Villa. Still no sign yet of Tony Daly coming on. But it must be in the mind of Graham Taylor to make the switch. There is Daly. And if he does, he'll get a great reception from the Villa fans. Olney. It's still 1-1 here. Both goals coming in the first half. Ormondroyd. We've had now an hour of this game. Price popping it forward. Here's the former Manchester United goalkeeper. His first to react. Had 6 years at Old Trafford. Now, really establishing a first team place, of course. Doubtful for this game anyway because of injury, a leg injury. He's in trouble again here. Just receiving some treatment from Jim Walker. Bit of a lunging tackle on him.
But I think in many ways that's that was a result of the system they're playing, Middlesbrough. They're playing very much a pressing game, not giving Villa a chance to try to settle and build up a pattern of play.
Mountfield with the free kick. Ormondroyd, all 6'4" of him, couldn't reach that one. Absolutely teeming down now. Pears out of his 6-yard area to smother the ball. Well, Peter With, back in the dry, the studio can hear you, Ron. I wonder what his thoughts are on the game at the moment. Peter, how do you think it's going?
Hello.
How do you think it's going at the moment, Peter?
Well, I think they're working very, very hard. I think Middlesbrough have done tremendous, really. They're closing them down. They've changed the system now, Aston Villa. And I think that they've tried to come out a bit more, but all credit to Middlesbrough. I mean, they've done exceptional. They're working hard. I thought they'd missed the boy Mowbray, but they haven't. They've done exceptionally well.
Yeah, I think, Peter, just thinking there, do you not think today they're holding a very high position up the field? They're trying to stop Villa getting anywhere near the penalty area, aren't they? Put those crosses in and let some of their big guys get in at it.
Here's Cowans now for Villa, driving the ball across the area, and Pearce holding on. Straight to Kerr. Off goes Ripley. Kernaghan in the middle. That was an important interception then by Mountfield. Another player whose game has been lifted by his move to Villa Park, Derek Mountfield. Took a little while to settle. After so much success, of course, at Everton. I'm hoping now for more honours with Aston Villa. And every chance of that this season. But here's Ripley now. Middlesbrough continuing to press. Whenever the opportunity comes their way, they certainly aren't just sitting back. Kernaghan, picked in by Slaven almost half-heartedly then. Now, Platt. Birch. He's got away from McGee. Whipping the crossover. Pears with a fine piece of goalkeeping then. And the threat from Ole. Birch got away down the right. A very difficult ball for the goalkeeper to deal with, Rob.
Yes, he's looked at it all the way. He's taken it well. Wasn't, no offence, put under pressure from the Villa strikers, but nevertheless handled a greasy ball very well.
Just look at that rain now.
But I think you saw a first-class example of what Daly might do if he comes on. We saw Birch go flying past young McGee there. And I just wonder, with 15, 20 minutes left, whether Graham will risk Daly and say, go on, if there's a dry part on the pitch, or the driest part on the pitch is on the wings, can he get good possession and go at the young kid?
It's still 1-1 at Villa Park. The second leg still to come, of course, at Ayresome Park. A match you can see live on Sky. Indeed, we'll also be showing the two legs of the Southern Area semi-final and the final itself, of course, at Wembley. And in fact, tonight's Southern semi-final, Crystal Palace against Swindon, has been postponed, so the weather is pretty bad down in London too. And it wasn't too clever when I left Dorset this afternoon either. Free kick to Middlesbrough. And Graham Taylor is going to make the substitution. Tremendous roar around the ground. It's Birch who's going off. It's a natural switch, of course. And that isn't proving too popular with the crowd. I think they've been well pleased with Birch's showing. Much as they like Daly to come on. He's let nobody down, and he's getting a terrific round of applause as he goes off. So Daly on for Bertrand.
Yes, and I think that is certainly a tactical situation. That's what you have to become conditioned to now. He's got a fresh pair of legs. Daly's a flying machine, and he might just cause enough problems in the sort of closing part of the game.
He really is extremely quick, Tony Daly. I don't think there's a quicker player in the Football League. But here's a chance. Oh, what a save! Proctor with a header, and spiked out so well. Proctor almost broke through then for Middlesbrough. And what a tremendous reaction save by Nigel Spink. Middlesbrough have had chances in the second half to have won the game, let alone draw it. And it's hard to believe we're seeing a team at the top of the first division against one struggling in the second. It really hasn't looked that way. And Mark Proctor then with a header. That so nearly sneaked Middlesbrough in front. Down goes Spink, right on the line. Ripley. He was brave then, but it got nowhere. Here's Daly, his first touch of the ball. Slaven. Cairns in here. Now for Gage. Pushing forward in the second half into a midfield role. Clumsy pass though. Well, that was a great chance for Proctor, Ron.
Well, I say it was a great chance. He took it very well. I mean, in all fairness to Mark, he's not the greatest header in the world, although he has in his time got a few headed goals. I'd prefer to say he timed his run very well, and he had to head it from a fair distance.
It's still 1-1. But you have to say that in the second half, anyway, it's Middlesbrough who've looked the more likely to score. What a night. Cowans, Ormondroyd knocking it down. Ripley. Here's Daly, skipping past the tackle. The freshest man on the field. There are some FA Cup matches being played, fourth round replays. Cambridge United 0, Millwall 0. So Cambridge United continuing to do well there against First Division Millwall. Is the latest scores, and Watford, they're trailing now. Sheffield United by 2-1 at Vicarage Road. The match, of course, all about Dave Bassett, manager of Sheffield United now, but a former Watford manager. A chance for Olney, and he didn't get hold of it. In fact, it was planted there, I think.
Yes, that was as much down to the conditions as anything, though, Peter. I mean, the centre-half, Moen was very unlucky to miss it when he skidded by him. And then Platy couldn't quite get a grip on the ball.
The rain is so torrential in there now. This is Platt. It's really hard to see who's out there. was definitely Platt who squandered the chance. Yes, it's raining. Good heavens. Play is going on. There's thunder, driving rain, and there's a football match going on out there somewhere.
I've got a feeling it's not going to go on for much longer, though, if this scoops up.
It really is absolutely horrendous now. Well, he's still smiling, Lester Shapter. He says he's only ever called one match off in the past, and he doesn't intend to start now. This is what he was saying before the game. I wonder if he reckoned on this weather, though. It's appalling out there. Now, Daly on the break. The first chance to show his acceleration, perhaps, but no, so quickly closed down by McGee and Brennan.
Watching Mark Brennan there, working hard to help out the young fullback to get his tackle. He ran a long way to get his tackle. He's played that way today, and that's something in the past that's been levelled against him. He's always had a great talent, but people have sometimes questioned his ability to maybe work hard enough for a midfield player.
Warman Droyd chasing here. Well, the rain has ceased a little, and there was a spell then when it was coming down in buckets. Now, is this another chance developing? Down goes Platt. No penalty.
It's amazing, isn't it? There's a discussion point whether David Platt is a better sort of second striker or a midfield player. Certainly since he's pushed up there, he's had two very good chances, albeit I think he's missed due to conditions. And they're just there, and then he's had what could have been a reasonable claim for a penalty. I don't think it was, but a reasonable claim all the same.
One came the way of Olney too. So Villa have had chances in the second half, but so too have Middlesbrough. And here they come again now. Brennan. Good tackle on Slaven. Here's Cowan's. Not really the sort of conditions for a player of Cowan's class to excel in. But of course, one telling pass from him could unhinge this Middlesbrough defence. Now Daly. Mishit it. He can be a bit frustrating too at times, Daly. Excellent a player though he is. That's one way to keep trying. He's a ball boy. And he's not paid for this either. Ripley. Here's Kerr. Kernahan down the middle, and Slaven hoping for the cross. Ormondroyd with the tackle. And I dread to think what the laundry bill is going to be for this one tonight. Ripley, the decision going Middlesbrough's way. Supporters still in great voice here, and what a fillip it will be for Middlesbrough if they can't hold Aston Villa, with the second leg still to come up at Ayresome Park, and that promises to be quite a match now. Don't forget, of course, the winners go on to Wembley for the final of the Zenith Cup. You can see that game live on Sky, as you can see the two legs of the Southern Area final. Chelsea are through to play the winners of Crystal Palace and Swindon. Just to recap that match tonight, the first leg at Selhurst Park has been called off because of the dreadful weather down there in London. It's not too clever here either. That was the Southern Area semi-final. Steered back by Kent Nielsen. Ron, if you had to put your money on anyone now, who would you favour at this stage?
Certainly the second half, I felt that prior to that little bit of a mini storm we had, the Middlesbrough looked a much better side. They played with a fair bit of control, but got a bit of a problem in midfield here. Is it Proctor?
The player down injured, I think it is Proctor. And the referee stopped play immediately then, taking no risks, and quickly called on the trainer. people are wearing tonight, Rob.
That's right. Yeah, as we were saying, I thought Middlesbrough were controlling the game until we had that little bit of a cloud outburst, and all of a sudden, in that spell, Villa had two or three very, very good situations. But it seems to have levelled itself out again now. And pick a winner would be very, very difficult. I must confess, every time Ripley gets the ball from Middlesbrough, I get the feeling that he's going to cause them a lot of problems. He has been causing them problems all night, and he's looked a very, very big threat.
He's been capped at under-21 level for England, and he does look a very good player. Had his little contretemps with McGrath in the first half. But thankfully, anyway, Potter is all right. 15 minutes left. Aston Villa 1, Middlesbrough 1. A drop ball, and Aston Villa back in possession. Trying to get Daly away down the flank as the ball almost reaches us up on the gantry. Ron Atkinson with a glancing header back onto the pitch. That took you back a bit, Ron. Price with the throw. In case you're wondering about our health up here, we are actually in the dry. Here's Daly whipping the crossover. Holman Droid now for Cowans. Great save from Pears. Cowans arrowing his shot towards the top corner. Middlesbrough stretched then by the run down the right from Daly. And what a good save that from Pears. McGee cutting it out this time. He's had a good second half, the goalkeeper, Ron.
Oh, yeah, very, very. He's done very well since he's gone to Middlesbrough. Very safe and reliable. Worked very hard at his game to make himself a very good, not first division keeper at the moment, but certainly when he was in the first division last season, played very, very well.
Here it is again. It was Daly who made that run. Holman Droy just knocking it off there. And Cowans swirled that with his right foot. Pierce kept it out. Clawed it from under the bar. Tie swinging from end to end, and certainly no way can you predict how it's going to finish. And this really only the first half, with the second leg at Ayresford Park still to come. Now Kerr. Middlesbrough have got four up. With Slaven waiting in the penalty area. Here's Parkinson in towards Slaven. Little flick off. Although the ball stuck in the mud, there was no other Middlesbrough player arriving on the scene. It's a free kick to Middlesbrough, which does not meet with the approval of the Aston Villa supporters, or the players come to that. Parkinson taking the free kick. Kernahan. The big men from the back for Middlesbrough. Although in fact I see only Coleman now has come forward. Mohan has stayed back, so they don't want to risk anything at this late stage. At the same time, Middlesbrough are searching for a winner. Here's the corner. Only half cleared. Kerr, Brennan again. Slaven and Coleman still in there. Slaven. Here's Ripley. And it was Nielsen who got in before Coleman. Now Kerr. Parkinson. Parkinson again. Olney is the target here. Slaven for Middlesbrough.
Oh, I think that's a risk ball on a night like
this. Just
going to say. Oh, just one of those needs to stick and it's game, set and match, shouldn't it?
He didn't look all that confident about it either. But he managed to get it back to his goalkeeper, did Bernie Slaven. So here's McGee then, with the throw for Middlesbrough. Field with the chip. That denied. It's a Villa throw now. taken by Chris Price. Here's Platt, now Daly. Daly again. Now Stuart Gray. In towards Platt. There's quick to respond again. Now off goes Slaven. He's got Ripley wide here. Kernahan down the middle. Still Ripley. There's danger for Villa here. Slaven. Came back off the defender. Kerr. My word. Aston Villa then were living dangerously. It came off Stuart Gray.
That's Slaven at his best. I mean, in the second half, he's had very, very few touches. But there's good running by Ripley, good setting up situation. As I say, he's had very, very few touches. It's very unlucky not to score there. And he's had two other situations in this half, Slaven. One a little half header, and the other the rather tame right-footed shot that on another night might have gone in for him.
And he has scored Middlesbrough's goal in this game. It's 1-1. Villa taking the lead through Birch. Middlesbrough coming straight back with the goal from Slaven. All that happening, as I say, early on in the game. A lot of chances in the second half. It swung from end to end, but it's still 1-1. And it really could go either way with 5 minutes left.
I have to say this, I think Bruce Rioch's team organisation and planning for the game has been spot on. He's decided the best way to try and win the game was to press the game and not let Villa too close to their goal too many times, rather than just sit and absorb pressure.
And the reins were in my stopwatch. There are 9 minutes to go. Now they're enjoying it anyway. Ripley. It broke kindly for him then. Still Ripley, he's got away from Gray. Nielsen this time heading it away. Out for a throw over on the far side.
He's certainly forced himself into some good situations tonight. Possibly his final ball hasn't always been as accurate as he would have liked it.
But he has been a real menace up front, Ripley. There's an injury now to one of the Villa players over there. It's Stoke Mountfield. Leicester Shapter looking on. And Mountfield seems to be okay. Not long to go now. And then the warm bath. It's a Borough throw. Taken by Kerr. Only partially cleared by Gray. Proctor. Ripley. He's given it over to Cowans. Now can he find Olney? He has. That was an important tackle then. Kernahan. Brennan's gone outside him. Now has that opened up a path to goal? Well, he might hold his head. What an inspired second half Middlesbrough have had. Kernahan this time. The battle going on down below us here with Daly involved. Ripley trying to shake off Nielsen. And he's managed to do so. But still Ripley.
Well, we've just seen two smashing efforts from the Borough front two. You saw the power once again there of Ripley, the way he shrugged off Nielsen. And just a little bit earlier, Kernahan's had the shot that's just narrowly skimmed Spinks's goal. And at this moment, you're talking about a result. Look at this one.
Not too far away from the post, with Spinks sprawling across. Now, Bruce Rioch must be so proud of his team's display. They really have turned on the power. Down there near the foot of the second division, remember. Playing the team right up there at the top of the first. Now Daly, Villa probing for a winner. Appeals for a penalty, nothing given. Still Daly. Platt turning. Gage. It's gone wide. relief on the terrace behind the goal.
I must confess, little McGee at left back is a very, very unorthodox defender. It looks as if he's just been given the sole responsibility of saying, whoever plays out on that side of the field, you take care of. Don't worry about anything else, covering situations or anything. Well, credit to him, he's played against good players tonight and done well.
But you really can't praise Middlesbrough too highly, Ron. I mean, the way they've come here tonight, playing a side so much in form. And in the second half in particular, well, they've had opportunities, they could have won it. And they're certainly well in this cup tie, with the second leg still to come. 5 minutes to go. Price again. Now, here's Platt to Daly. Price has stayed up. Almondroy, he couldn't fall for him. He lunged out one of those long legs and he couldn't make a decisive contact. Middlesbrough survive. They've got Slaven in oceans of space upfield. They can find him. Only as far though as Price. Clogging mud up there now. The drama right to the end. Here's Daly. He's got three, four in the middle. Took a deflection. Daly. Mountfield. Rather tamely though. Mountfield again. Price. Too long for Gage. Well, Ron, you've played Middlesbrough, Sheffield Wednesday, you've lost 4-1 up there. How difficult a match are Aston Villa going to have?
Well, on the evidence of tonight, in actual fact, Middlesbrough have played better tonight than they did when they beat us 4. They've been very compact, and we've been talking about Ripley, we've been talking about other players, but I think the central defender Coleman's had an absolutely outstanding game, because he's had to play in a comparatively inexperienced back four. And you made a mention earlier, you said he won an important tackle. He's won all the important situations tonight. No, and that's one of the marks of any good defender, is he reliable? And he's been very, very reliable this evening.
And they've certainly needed him in the absence of Tony Mowbray. And Coleman has risen to the occasion. But then all the Middlesbrough players have. They're 3 minutes away now from what will be an outstanding result for them.
And don't forget, when they go back, they're highly likely to have both Mowbray and there's a possibility maybe Peter Davenport might be fit. Because he's hit a good form streak playing on the left-hand side of midfield.
Yes, he had a lean spell, Peter Davenport, since his move to Ayrton Park, but he's, as Rob was saying, come back into form a bit lately. Got a goal against Sunderland the other week, but he's out through injury. I think Bruce Rudolph will find it hard to leave anybody out after this show. Ripley's lost it. Almondroy. There are now just 2 minutes of normal time to go. A little bit of time for Leicester Shakhtar to add on. We've had some injuries in this game, unsurprisingly really, on this dreadful surface. And a real cut-tie atmosphere, and Middlesbrough still ploughing on. They've got another free kick. As Kerr goes down.
Well, no one would have been more delighted than Kerr to have scored the winner, wouldn't he? The place where he started his career. Ironically enough, as a striker.
Now, there's a genuine opportunity here for Middlesbrough. Especially in these conditions, anything might happen. And Villa have everybody back defending this free kick.
It may just be a touch too far, but... A little bit closer in, I'd be betting money on Proctor to have a sort of bender on this. It is like a swing shot, and of course Parkinson, as we saw against Everton, can whack a ball.
And also Brennan there too, and here is Brennan. Driven through! Oh, what a goal! Magnificent goal! There are Middlesbrough supporters on the pitch. Bruce Rudolph yelling for his team to calm down now. And there is a fan out on the pitch. Others have been ushered away. What a strike then by Brennan.
Blinding strike. As you were just saying here, he's got a fierce left foot. great finish, tremendous finish. And maybe a little bit of poetic justice because Carroll considered himself badly done to when he pulled down.
Well, Middlesbrough's second half is almost complete now. They've played superbly here and they now lead by 2-1. The second goal from Mark Brennan. And just look at those delighted fans. The trip was worthwhile. They won't mind about the rain now. And what a happy journey. It's going to be back to the northeast. Mark Brennan, only his second goal of the season. What an important one. It might yet take them towards Wembley. It really was a ferocious drive from Brennan. Now, can Middlesbrough hold on here? Aston Villa, those 12 successive home wins behind them, are in danger of losing now.
They've also been given a free kick against them, I would consider a very, very harsh decision.
Here's the free kick, taken by Stuart Gray. They've got everybody back, and somehow they've steered it back, but now he's lost it, the goalkeeper. It slipped away from his grasp, he stayed down, he may well have got a whack then. Stephen Pearce was so brave and courageous, but he lost the ball, and the referee didn't give a free kick. And a few of those Middlesbrough fans behind the goal, a few hearts skipped a beat then. What a finale to this game. Stephen Pearce, who's made some heroic saves in the second half.
If the score does stay this way, Peter, I don't think anyone could begrudge the Borough it. Middlesbrough played very, very well the second half.
They've done it! They've won by 2-1. And as Aston Villa trooped dejectedly off the field, just look at those elated faces, not only among the players, but the Middlesbrough fans too, behind that goal, applauded now by the players. They've come from behind, the early goal from Birch didn't deter them. Slaven with a quick equaliser, and then this man, Brennan, Mark Brennan, the former Ipswich player, with a quite stupendous shot from the free kick. And what a second leg we're in for now up at Anson Park. No way, of course, can you write Aston Villa off the sort of season they're having, but Middlesbrough have every chance now of going on to Wembley. The full-time score here in the first leg, the Northern final of the Zenit Cup, Aston Villa 1, Middlesbrough 2.
Welcome back to Villa Park. Middlesbrough of Division 2 have stolen the thunder from the pacemakers in Division 1, Aston Villa. Down at pitch side, Matthew Lorenzo is with the man, the architect of this victory tonight, Bruce Rioch, Middlesbrough manager. Matthew.
Bruce Rioch, Borough manager, you must be more than overpleased with that performance.
Well, in a very terrible evening, obviously, we're very pleased with the performance. Went a goal down, but got the goal back very quickly indeed, which helps. And then we've got the second one a few minutes from the end of the game. But the boys have been fantastic. We've had quite a few injuries. We've missed Mowbray, we've missed Davenport tonight. Hamilton's out, Comfort's out. So we have quite a lot of people missing. But it was a great game for us and a great in bad conditions. And we'll take one game at a time. We're grateful that we're on Sky Television. We've enjoyed it. I watch it. My family at home are watching. I know a lot of other people are watching it. And we look forward to the second leg in a week's time.
What about the supporters you brought down here? It's really been terrific all night long.
Well, they're fantastic supporters. They've been brilliant on Teesside all season. We've not had the best of seasons in the league. But our cup performances this year have been very good. We've had the three games against Everton. In the Zenith Data Systems Cup, we overcome Port Vale, Sheffield Wednesday, and here tonight we've got a good result against Villa. But all to play for now in the second leg.
I'm looking forward to it. Thanks very much, Bruce.
Thanks a lot.
Back to you, Paul.
Matthew, thanks very much indeed. Go in and get dry. Bruce Rioch can't help Peter with, but start to dream about Wembley somewhere.
Yeah, I mean, it's a great result. I mean, I was listening to Ron saying about the players and the team. To me, it was right through the middle as far as I was concerned. It was the two centre-backs, two midfield players and the two strikers done brilliantly.
Let's pick up on the two midfield men in particular who came out second half and really got a grip on Cowans
in midfield, Brennan and Proctor, yeah. And Brennan ends by scoring the goal that wins the tie for Middlesbrough.
Yeah, he ends up, I think he got the bonus from Bruce Rioch, really. I think that the manager has scored a few left foots in his time, and he struck it brilliantly. Really.
We'll see that in a minute. But on Brennan, a guy whose career seemed to go down the pan at Ipswich, and he's been picked up now, and on tonight's evidence, been turned into a very good midfield player.
Yeah, I thought him and Proctor had done ever so well, really. They played against... Platt was playing in midfield in the first half with Gordon Cowan, but it's certainly in the second half when they changed it round to Gates. I thought they made some great runs. They had got some good chances in. Proctor had a great header coming through from the middle, and they wasn't being picked up.
Right, now we can actually have a look at the goal, I think, in just a second or two. Remember, 88 minutes gone. Villa conceding a free kick on the edge. Peter, just talk us through it.
Yeah, I mean, he's touched it to one side. He struck it brilliantly. Bruce Rioch would have been proud of that. And it's going away all the time. It's a bit like the boy Ripley in the first half. He hits a similar sort of shot, but it's going away from the keeper all the time. It's a great strike.
And Spinks at full stretch here. Does he get a piece of it? Not really.
I don't think so, no. I don't think so.
Right,
I think it's
corner.
Always going away from him.
And the fantastic reception from the fans, Middlesbrough fans, who followed them here tonight.
They've been brilliant. I mean, I drove down and I was passing them on the. They were all coming down in coaches and cars and one thing and another. They're still here singing the praises, and I think they've been brilliant.
And I think they'll be singing their praises again next week when we go to Ayresford Park. We'll be following them. Terrific second leg in prospect. Aston Villa have got to go there and win the game and score at least twice to do it. It'll be something well worth watching next Tuesday, 7:30, live only on Sky One. I think you'll agree, our cup football on Sky One has started with a bang. Thanks very much for being with us. We'll be seeing you again next Tuesday night. Stay indoors. With Peter once again.